shoulders, and together they struggled to carry him to the van. Loki came too slowly, and when he did, he was aware of a bumping, rocking movement all around him, and boxes bearing blinking colored lights on his left and right sides. He was lying on his back, on a metal floor, staring up at a dark ceiling, and he was moving. They were moving. He heard their voices, those of the two mortal women who had found him, and even as he laid there, his side fairly splitting open, he could not believe the hand fate had dealt. He knew her as soon as the beams of light cut across her slight figure. Her long, wind-blown dark hair, comely face, and startled brown eyes. He had watched her every movement from his throne in Asgard, through the eyes of the destroyer, a thoughtful finger draped across his lips. He had seen the way she and Thor had looked at each other in the mists of the breaking and burning. He had known it was she that had made Thor weak. Jane. That was her name. And she already knew about Asgard, and Odin, and the bridge, for she had doubtlessly followed the passage he had just made, and she was clearly in love with Thor. But she had never seen Loki. She only knew of him. Which meant Loki was not about to be handed over to the authorities, nor jabbed by medieval doctors, nor interrogated by their lawmen as Thor had been. Not while Jane wanted answers concerning Thor and Asgard. So Loki would hide behind an alias and milk that advantage for all it was worth. Jane opened the back of the van to see Fenris sitting up, his jaw set. He looked irritated. "How are you feeling?" Jane asked. "I can't say that was enjoyable," he answered, laboriously scooting himself forward with his left hand, so his feet dangled out and then rested on the ground. "And I believe my brains have been rattled to pieces, thank you." A retort sprang to Jane's lips, but then Fenris reached up and swiped at his forehead, and then stared at his bloody hand. "Good heavens," he muttered, making a face. "We need to get you inside," Jane urged. "Here, let me help you." She bravely took hold of his stiff arm once more and pulled him up. He didn't say anything to consent, but he didn't pull away either. His face had gone tight, and his footsteps were unsteady. "Darcy, get his other side, would you?" Jane called.
"Kay,"
Darcy acknowledged, then took hold of Fenris' left arm. Together, they guided him to their glass-walled lab and managed to trundle him through the side door. Absently, Jane mused that Fenris was not as tall as Thor, nor as grand. But then she supposed that not everyone in Asgard could be born with his natural majesty. After all, Thor was a prince. The shadow and twinkling lights of the state-of-the-art lab made Jane blink, trying to adjust her eyes as their footsteps shuffled hollowly across the tile. "Darcy, go flip the lights on, will you?" Jane panted, steering Fenris toward the counter and sink. He leaned his hands against the edge of the white countertop, and Jane was about to protest about his getting blood all over, but he hung his head low and closed his eyes. She bit her lip, opened a low cupboard, and pulled out several soft washcloths. Then she turned on the water. It hissed into the sink. Fenris' eyes came open, and he frowned down at the tumbling liquid. The stark, fluorescent overhead lights snapped on. Jane glanced over at Darcy, who stayed safely by the light switch at the far end of the lab, watching the stranger. Jane leaned around his arm, soaked the washcloth in warm water and squeezed it out, then brought it, dripping, up to the side of his head. "People's heads always bleed so much," she muttered as she pressed the cloth to his forehead and began wiping away the blood. Sometimes the littlest cut can bleed like crazy. That's entirely untrue of Asgardians, Fenris replied, pulling the cloth out of her hands and pressing it to his head himself. Oh, Jane stammered, thrown. Deftly, he wiped the blood off his face, leaned down and rinsed the rag out in the water, then continued washing, like a cat bathing its face. Jane pulled back from him, a frown settling on her face. Whatever this Fenris was, he was not at all like Thor. How did you hurt yourself? Jane finally asked. Fell from the the bridge, he answered, water dripping off his nose and lips. He soaked the rag again, squeezed it out, then pressed it to his temple. During the fight between Thor and his brother Loki, Jane's heart jolted. Fight? Thor fought him? What happened? She demanded, pressing closer. She sensed Darcy draw a little nearer too, but Jane's eyes were fixed on Fenrir's face. He didn't look at her. Loki was attempting to unleash the power of the Bifrost upon Asgard's longtime enemies, the Frost Giants. Thor arrived and decided he would not let his brother succeed. Fenris wiped the excess water from his face, put the rag down, and began feeling through his black hair for his wound. But the gate had locked, so there was nothing for Thor to do but break the bridge with his hammer, which is what he did. But it... Fenris dropped his right arm and pulled it close to his chest, wincing, his face going even whiter. What? Jane said quickly. Are you hurt someplace else? I am fine. Where may I sit down? He asked through his teeth. Here. Jane leaped across to her desk and swung her wheeled chair around for him. Fenris eased down into it and swallowed hard, his eyes drifting shut. What then? Jane asked, leaning closer.
Jane, don't you think he should rest for a sec?
Darcy wondered, stepping closer, studying his face. I am fine, Fenris repeated, his eyes opening to glare at Darcy. The bridge broke, he went on, and it caused a tremendous explosion. I was one of the guards on the bridge. The blast threw me off, and I fell down into the funnel of the path. I landed here, in the middle of nowhere. His eyes closed again, and his brow furrowed in what looked like anger. Jane stood there, feeling cold. So, the bridge broke? Yes, Fenris answered, still not looking at her. Jane gulped, her throat hurting with the movement. So, can Thor? I mean, can he come back? Her voice trailed off into faintness. Fenris' eyes opened, and he arched an eyebrow at her. As it stands, no. Not unless he knows another way to travel between realms, which he doesn't. Jane stood there, her brow twisting, staring at the stranger, unable to move. She felt Darcy's eyes on her, but she dared not meet them. If it's not too much to ask, Fenris sighed darkly, is it possible that there is anything with which to kill pain on this rock, or must I shoot myself to get a little relief? So sorry, Jane said breathlessly, stumbling across the room again to another cupboard. I think I have some migraine Tylenol. Her fumbling hands found the latch of the cabinet, and she pulled the door open, though it was hard to search the labels on the bottles when tears clouded her vision.